So let's say we have three DNA samples from three kids. We'll call them kids A, B, and C. And we want to know their genotypes at a particular locus, and we've PCR amplified DNA from all three of these individuals. Two of the things that we're going to need to do are to have a positive control sample, or more than one, and a negative control sample. So for templates, we're going to want to have samples from kids A, B, and C. We'll probably want to have their parents' DNA too, because the kids' DNA should match both of the parents ideally. So we're going to call that M for maternal and P for paternal. And those should offer a sort of positive control reaction. Their DNA should amplify the same amplicons or DNA fragments as the kids. And then we'll also have one W, which is a negative control, and the W stands for water. This is the most critical control experiment to perform for PCR because we don't have any DNA in a tube of water. And if we add water by itself, no DNA, as the template in a PCR reaction, along with TAC and primers and NTPs and all the other ingredients, there should be no template molecule, and so there should be no amplicons. There should be no DNA that is produced as a result of PCR from this negative control reaction. So we get all of these DNA samples, we PCR amplify them for a specific locus, a specific gene that we want to genotype all these individuals for. And we're going to have then 6 different PCR samples, which again I've referred to as amplicons, fragments of DNA that have been amplified by PCR. And we need a way to figure out what the sizes of these different molecules of DNA are. Remember from the setup of PCR that we dictate the size of the PCR product by where we position the sequences of the primers that we create to perform PCR. And in this case, I'm envisioning that we have something like an indel, and I'll explain that a little bit more detail in just a minute. When we have PCR samples, amplicons, what the scientist does is analyze them by agarose gel electrophoresis. And what this is it's a big slab of what you could think of as jello, essentially. So a big rectangular piece of jello. It's actually melted agar. And at one end, there are depressions, little holes that go down into the agar, where samples can be added, like, for example, our DNA samples. And so what a scientist will do is they'll add, say, sample A, sample B, and sample C of our PCR amplicons into this gel. And those will just be floating there in liquid in this gel. Down here, about in the middle of the gel from top to bottom. Now we need to separate these DNA molecules based on size. And the way that we do that is that we know that DNA has a negative charge because of the phosphate backbone. The phosphate molecules have a negative charge. And so the way that we separate these DNA molecules based on their size is we apply an electric field where we put the cathode at the far end of the gel and an anode at the near end of the gel where we've loaded the samples. And when we apply this electric field, the DNA migrates down the gel because it's negatively charged. Those negative charges are attracted to the positive cathode. And here's the most critical thing to remember about agarose gel electrophoresis. Which bands move, or which sizes of DNA move farther faster? Is it the big ones or the small ones? And this is always a really intense debate when we do it in class, because it seems like there are two schools of thought. One is that the bigger molecules of DNA have more phosphates on them, and that's more negative charge, so it should move faster. But it turns out that the opposite is actually true. The smaller fragments will migrate faster through the gel in a particular length of time than the large fragments. And that's because we're trying to push DNA through jello. And that jello makes a really fine mesh, the agar, when it's melted, makes a really fine mesh. And the smallest pieces of DNA can migrate through those holes in between the agarose molecules faster than a huge piece of DNA that's trying to be pulled through this mesh. So the small pieces of DNA go farther down the gel in a particular length of time than the large pieces of DNA. So now I'm going to re-diagram this gel like we're looking at it from the top down. Give myself a little bit more space to indicate our different samples. So we have the kids, A, B, and C. We have a paternal sample. We have a maternal sample. We have a water control. And there's one more thing that we have to add to this gel, which I'll describe in a minute, and that's MW. That's not maternal water. That's molecular weight standard, or sometimes called molecular weight ladder. So again, the positive charges here at the bottom of the gel, the negative charge is placed at the top. Each of these samples gets loaded into its own little hole in the gel. The electric fields applied, the DNA is going to migrate from the top of the gel down to the bottom of the gel. So this usually happens for an hour and a half or two in the laboratory before we stop and we take this gel out and we actually look at it. Critical point. We can't see DNA with our eyes. Not only is it too skinny and too small a molecule, but it doesn't have any contrast with the agar. So we have to add a dye to this gel to help us visualize the DNA molecules. And in most labs, we use a dye called ethidium bromide. Which is often abbreviated ETBR. And this is a chemical carcinogen, so we have to take extra special care when we use this. Because it binds to DNA, we don't want to bind to our DNA, just the DNA that's in the gel. But what ethidium bromide does is when it binds to DNA, it fluoresces under black light. So we take this gel, we stain it with ethidium bromide, and then we shine a UV light or black light on this, and then we can start to see the patterns. And for example, what we might see here is that there are lines, which we call bands, from every sample. And what these indicate, for example, is we have the paternal DNA sample has produced two different sized pieces of DNA as a result from PCR amplification. And it looks like the same is true from the maternal sample. Fortunately, in this case, the water sample, we have no bands, which is good. We're not supposed to have any amplification of DNA from a reaction that has no template DNA in it in the first place. If there ever is a band in the water control, the entire gel results are basically invalid. We have to try again until that water lane is empty. So here comes the actual analysis. Those are the positive control wells. Now we know mom and dad's genotypes, and we have a negative control well. So what are the kids' DNA samples going to look like? So let's imagine that kid A, we see one band, kid B, we see one band, and here's the third child, has two bands. What does this mean? To answer that question, one of the things that we're going to have to do is to know what are the sizes in terms of base pairs of these bands. And that's where the molecular weight ladder comes in handy. So what goes in the molecular weight ladder lane is a mixture of DNA samples that we know the sizes of. So that might be a tube that contains fragments of DNA that are 1,000 base pairs, 500 base pairs, 250 base pairs, and 100 base pairs, for example. We put those all in one tube, and we add that sample into that well of the agarose gel. So when we electrophorese this sample, applying an electric current, we should see 1, 2, 3, 4 bands. And indeed, we do. So my question to you, two of them. First, what are the sizes of these bands from the samples A, B, C, and the paternal and the maternal sample? And also, why do we see different band patterns in the children than the parents? We'll talk about that in class.